This is Literary Atlanta. I'm Allison Law. We are just one day away from the 2018 AJC Decatur Book Festival. You know, some people don't realize that I am not working on the festival this year. I'm not there in an official capacity as I was in 2013 and then again last year when I served as Associate Program Director. I did volunteer a little bit of my time this year, aka being nosy and hanging out at the DBF office to see if Executive Director Julie Wilson and Programming Manager Joy Pope would tell me who's coming, what's going on. But those two ladies, along with Diane Capriola and her team in charge of the children's and YA programs, they're running the show. And then there's Mike Miller and Noni Ravenberg and the festival board and the city of Decatur and corporate sponsors and a whole cast of volunteers. I remember stepping onto the Decatur Square on the first day of the festival last year, looking around at all the tents and people and wondering, how in the hell did all of this come together? I'm just always, always amazed. Fortunately, I will be facilitating a couple of sessions at this year's festival on Saturday at 10 a.m. in the Decatur Presbyterian Church. I'm thrilled to be interviewing Madeline Miller, whose fictional deep dive into one of the minor characters from Greek mythology and Homer's The Odyssey, Circe, became a runaway New York Times bestseller this year. Circe introduces herself in the beginning of the book as the least of the lesser goddesses, then looms large throughout this epic novel. I cannot wait to have that conversation with Madeline Miller. Then, Saturday at 4:15, I'll be moderating a discussion between author Hannah Pittard, who was our featured guest in episode 41 of Literary Atlanta. Hannah is going to be talking about her book, Visible Empire, and she'll be paired with the guest of this episode. My conversation with Rebecca Mackay, author of The Great Believers, is next on episode 46 of Literary Atlanta. Atlanta is a book town, home to avid readers and host to some of the finest writers and storytellers on the planet. That's my thesis statement, and this podcast provides the supporting details through behind-the-scenes anecdotes, author interviews, and all of the ways that you can experience the rich literary landscape right here in Literary Atlanta. Rebecca Mackay is the Chicago-based author of the novels The Borrower, The Hundred-Year House, and her latest book, which released in June, The Great Believers. The Great Believers is told from two different alternating points of view. First, we meet Yale Tishman in 1985. Yale is the development director for an art gallery in Chicago, and he's about to pull off an amazing coup, bringing in an extraordinary collection of 1920s paintings as a gift to the gallery. Yet, as his career begins to flourish, the carnage of the AIDS epidemic grows around him. One by one, his friends are dying, and after his friend Nico's funeral, the virus circles closer and closer to Yale himself. Soon, the only person he has left is Fiona, Nico's little sister. 30 years later, in 2015, Fiona is in Paris tracking down her estranged daughter who disappeared into a cult. While staying with an old friend, a famous photographer who documented the Chicago AIDS crisis, Fiona finds herself finally grappling with the devastating way that AIDS affected her life and her relationships. These two intertwining stories take us through the heartbreak of the 80s and the chaos of the modern world. In addition to her novels, Rebecca has also written a short story collection called Music for Wartime. Her short fiction won a 2017 Pushcart Prize and was chosen for the Best American Short Stories for four consecutive years, from 2008 to 2011. The recipient of a 2014 NEA Fellowship, Rebecca is on the MFA faculties of Sierra Nevada College and Northwestern University. As she also mentions in our interview, she is the artistic director of Story Studio Chicago and has taught at the renowned Iowa Writers Workshop and the Tin House Writers Conference, among others. That's why I was curious to know if Rebecca had broken any of her writing rules when it came to crafting this breakout book, the great believers?
I'll say that the reason I give this advice is because I really think it's good advice for a first novel. And this was not my first novel, so that's why I felt okay with breaking it. But I think that with so many writers for their first novel, they go for wildly ambitious structures. You want to write a novel, and the reason you want to is because you admire some really amazing novels that are, you know, the best novel of one of the best novelists of the 20th century at the height of his career, right? Mm-hmm. And you're like, I want to write like that. It's like and then they're kind of starting on like the Black Diamond slope in terms of structure, right? Like, I really like what Nabokov did. And it's like, whoa, hold up.
Yeah.
It is hard enough. It is so hard to write just a simple, linear, one point of view novel that happens in chronological order that goes from point A to point B. That is nearly impossible. Many, many people try and never even finish the novel, let alone, you know, the book-shaped objects in the world that aren't really there yet, right?
Yeah.
So often I see people, and specifically, my main teaching gig actually is that I am the artistic director at a place called Story Studio in Chicago, which is a, you know, nonprofit writing center. We do kind of all levels, and I teach a year-long novel writing workshop. I just admitted my 7th cohort, so I've been doing this. For 7 years, and these are really high-level writers. A lot of them have master's degrees, or they've been working at this for a long time, and every August, you know, get the new group in there. And every year, about half of them at least have just bitten off way more than they can chew, where it's like, I'm writing a 12 generational epic saga set in Beijing and the American West and also Alaska. and part of it is imagined from someone's prison cell based on these diaries that he inherited from his mother-in-law. You're like, oh my God, honey, stop. Pick one thing just for your first novel, right? Because if you told me that Colson Whitehead was going to do that, yeah, go do it, Colson Whitehead. Like, you're going to be fun, right? But for a first novel, stop. Just one thing at a time. Save that for your fourth book, your fifth book. So, you know, I do think my first novel was, I mean, it was playful in terms of structure, but it was one first-person narrator. It went chronologically from a certain day to a certain day. And then certainly my second novel goes backwards in time. So by that point, I was, you know, completely ignoring this advice. But at least I knew how hard it was just to write a novel, let alone to do structurally complicated stuff on top of it. So, it was my own damn fault, basically, because I knew what I was getting into. And so with this one too, you know, this, even though it's just back and forth between the two sections, that's a lot of, technically, you know, I really have 3 time periods in there. It was a lot to juggle. I don't think that I could have or should have done something like this for my first book necessarily.
The Great Believers alternates between 1985 from the point of view of Yale and 30 years later in 2015 from the point of view of Fiona. Originally, there was only the one timeline in the 1980s.
Mm-hmm.
How did you make that decision to add the second timeline?
It was not easy. The decision was not easy, nor was the writing, but I assume anyone listening knows that the writing wasn't easy. So here's what happened. I think early on, you kind of have a bit of a roadmap, but you also know that you are going to wind up, you know, going far away from it. So this wasn't some earth-shattering thing for me, but I'd written about 100 and maybe 150 pages of the way in with just Yale. If this gives anyone who's reading the book a sense of where that was, I think we'd made it, and I'm not giving away too much here, I think we'd made it through Terrence's funeral.
Mm-hmm.
And I was at Yaddo, the artist's colony, the artist residency in upstate New York, which is important because in this story, we were completely snowed in. We had like 3 feet of snow on the ground, huge icicles just literally barring in the windows of this tiny little third floor garret kind of studio where I was working, which was also super haunted. And it was where Sylvia Plath wrote The Colossus. And it was like, just, it's this, you know, tragic woman's tragic house that got turned into this colony. It's the most haunted place in the world. So I'm in this, you know, I'm barred in, snowed in this haunted attic. And it was about two and a half weeks into the residency. So you're already at this place where you're starting to go a little nuts.
Mm-hmm.
I started to have a couple of issues. One of them was I felt limited by the time frame. I really wanted to be able to show the aftermath of something like this. I wanted to be able to look back from a later point in time, partly because that was one of the things that was really fascinating to me in a lot of my interviews that I was conducting with people, was that 30-year gap of, you know, I was handed a death sentence in 1986 and I'm still here, you know. So I wanted that, and I started thinking of all these just, I was almost going to say goofy. I think I could have made it work, but really strange ways to do that. Like at the end, it would turn out that the whole thing was being narrated by someone like Julian during the story. And, you know, so I was playing with that. The other thing that was happening was I really was very concerned about issues of appropriation and the question of whether, as a straight woman, I was, quote unquote, allowed to write something like this, whether I could do it well, how it would be perceived. And the more that I was writing just from Yale's point of view, the more it felt possibly like, you know, an attempt at ventriloquism in some way, rather than a full fleshed out multifaceted novel. And I was very concerned. I came up with the idea of going back and writing Fiona's sections, but I had my own concerns about that. Namely, does it seem like a cop-out? Does it, you know, is that just going to feel like I'm sticking a straight woman in there just to do that? Is she going to come off as a savior character, which is the last thing I wanted? You know,
exactly.
I think we see that so often in books where someone's writing across race, where then you have a white savior character, like the last thing we need, right?
Yes.
So is it going to come off that way? Or can I make her flawed enough that that would clearly not be what I was doing? You know, it was kind of right at the end of my time there. I was having to come home early from Yaddo because of a family emergency, but then couldn't get to the airport because I was snowed in. So I just had a really interesting few days there of staring at my computer and staring out at the snow and trying to figure out what to do. I kind of decided to do the Fiona sections. And about a month later, I sat down and started writing them and weaving them in. And ultimately, you know, for me, that became the book, the not Fiona herself, but the play of those two time periods together.
I really took a lot of time with the book because you did such a remarkable job of weaving in the different details. It was like a conversation or a dialogue between those two time periods, between those alternating perspectives, because you had what was happening in the 80s, and then you had to carry it over into looking back on it. There's just such a sense of nostalgia in this book.
Yeah, which, you know, I think did come in many ways from my research. My own nostalgia for that time, although I was a child, I certainly can't be nostalgic myself for the gay bars of 1985. My parents were not taking me bar hopping when I was seven.
Right.
But certainly the time, you know, it's funny because I've gotten questions about how, you know, how did you write the 80s so well? And it was like, well, that's who I am. Like that, you know,
yeah.
that's everything I absorbed as a child. That's not the question you should be asking. I feel like I'm not comparing myself to him in any way, but I've always loved interviews with Matthew Weiner about Mad Men.
Mm-hmm.
He's recreating the 60s, for which he was a child. But all those images, you know, the details of what those ashtrays looked like, whatever it was, that's burned on his brain. So the nostalgia for the 80s is very much mine. The nostalgia for the Boys Town, which for those listening who don't know Chicago Boys Town, is exactly what it sounds like in Chicago. That was not mine, although it really became my nostalgia in a way for a place, for a time that I'd never been in that place. Just, you know, the interviews I had with people were so steeped in nostalgia, the way that they would start talking about someone and then kind of trail off, the way that they would start telling a story and say, oh my God, I haven't thought about this in 25 years. But by a little bit of the way in, I was in possession of certain memories or knowledge or details from my research that would come up as I was talking to someone, you know, seeing the, you know, the looks registering on their faces when I brought up a thing or a person that they hadn't thought of in so long. One of the many reasons I'm so glad that my research was not limited to books, which it couldn't have been, because there are basically no books about the AIDS crisis in Chicago, with a couple of exceptions. Getting out there and actually talking to people, that emotional realism, that nostalgia, it was like osmosis for me, absorbing people's, not just what they remembered, but how they remembered it.
Mm-hmm. And it's an odd thing too, because it's, as Fiona is kind of reuniting with Richard and these other people that she hasn't thought about or spent time with in many, many years, it's hard to be nostalgic about a time when many of your friends and family members have died.
Right. Yeah. And that's something that was something I certainly picked up on in talking to people that, you know, they talk about it. On the one hand, talking about it like it was the best time of their lives, and I completely understand why. You know, you're young, these are the friends of your youth, your 20s, you got all this energy, you were doing big, important things, you know, you were out on the street, you know, fighting these fights, and at the same time, just a time that you'd never want to revisit. And I completely understand how those two things can coexist, and that I was trying to get in there.
Yeah. Well, let me take a step back. Which part of the story came to you first? What inspired you to write The Great Believers?
Oh, yeah. No, I was trying to write a novel about an artist's model in Paris in the 1920s.
Oh, obviously. Yeah. I mean, that's kind of the third timeline to this. It's kind of hidden in the story.
Yeah, no, totally. That's what I wanted to write about. I had this kind of flash of inspiration. I was in New York City in probably 2013, and I saw this woman on the street she was so tall and striking and interesting looking. And I don't know that she was a model, but my impression was that she was. And I just started thinking about models and muses and artists' muses. And I was like, yeah, I want to write about, you know, someone whose art was to be a muse, you know, in a time when women maybe didn't have the resources to make their own art. And that was what it was going to be. It was going to be this woman looking back from the end of her life, which, you know, then I'm calculating like, okay, that can't be much later than the 80s. So this woman looking back at this time, and she has these, you know, pieces of art, or a piece of art that she's trying to prove was her, that she's something like that. And then, you know, she's in conversation with an art person. My next train of thought was, okay, I have an art guy in the 80s. I have been wanting to write about the AIDS crisis. Maybe this is an opportunity for AIDS to be a subplot, a background story in my book. Obviously, that's not what I ended up doing, because things shifted pretty dramatically. You know, I think it would have worked. I think it could have been, you know, Find the First Way, where it really was about her and his was the backstory. But the more I thought about it, I usually have a kind of a marinating phase with novels where I just think about them for like 6 months or a year.
Yeah.
It was in that phase that I was really, it's like, I don't want, you know, there are plenty of works of art that do use AIDS effectively as a subplot, but I just didn't feel like that was what I wanted to do. I didn't want to feel like I was relegating it to that. I wanted to, if I was going to do it, I wanted to look at it directly. And it felt more and more like the 1920s art world was the tenor to the metaphor.
Interesting. Yes, because Nora's life and that whole story about the artist that she was in love with and that she wants to revive, it models that the 1920s Paris and the lost generation around the First World War models kind of the lost generation of the Boys Town 1980s Chicago.
Right. Yeah. As I started reading, and I started my research with the Paris art world. And as I started reading about it, I was really struck by parallels I saw between the lost generation and the AIDS generation, where, you know, when we talk about the lost generation, we tend to be thinking about the writers who went to Paris after the war.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, but that's just because that's what, you know, Gertrude Stein was talking to Hemingway. She said, you are all a lost generation. But that generation, really, the visual artists were flocking to Paris before the war, from all over the world. And it was still the age of the Art Academy in Paris, and forming, you know, communities, chosen family. These are young people. They're in their 20s. They are living very hand to mouth. You know, all the stories you hear about the little tiny, you know, apartments they'd live in, and they'd burn their furniture for heat, you know.
Yeah.
They are, you know, starting, some of them, to thrive. They're getting along. And then World War I rolls through, and the influenza rolls through. And they're left after the war with just this decimated generation. They're just, you know, trying to find each other again. And especially the young men are gone. And I think, as most people know, you know, the influenza, for any number of reasons, primarily hit young, healthy men. So you look at that, and then you look at the AIDS generation, and you look at, you know, in a big city like Chicago, where you have people coming there often from other places alone, completely without their families, finding chosen family, finding community, starting to get their lives together, and then in comes AIDS. And that idea too of, you know, how do you pick up your life and move on when you've lost all the friends of your 20s, or when you really thought you yourself were going to die and you came in some ways to terms with that. And here you are, and it's 20 years later, it's 30 years later. And who holds the memories of all those people? And how long are you beholden to those memories? And what do you do with them? Those parallels were just so striking to me. And it became really the early backbone of the book.
This seems like such a daunting task to me, because not only did you do a magnificent job of researching the art, then how do you also take on medical terminology and the physical manifestations of the HIV virus and AIDS? Can you tell us how you broke down your research for this? Because I know you also had to do a lot of interviews and first-person accounts, because you, as you mentioned, there aren't a lot of books about the AIDS crisis in the 80s.
Well, there are. It's specifically, just to clarify that statement, what I specifically meant is there's not much about the AIDS crisis in Chicago.
In Chicago. Got it.
I would also say that there's not enough out there about the AIDS crisis, but there is a lot of great work out there. Especially there's a lot of really great new sort of general nonfiction, a book like How to Survive a Plague by David France. Cleve Jones has been writing amazing stuff for a long time, and there's plenty out there. And actually, on my website, if anyone's interested, I have a page. If anyone clicks through for the Great Believers in specific, then I have a resource page where, you know, one of the things I think I said on that resource page, but I've certainly said elsewhere, is that, you know, if this is the first thing someone's read about AIDS, or one of the first things, or the first thing in a long time, I really hope it's not the last. While there is very little, shockingly little, about Chicago in the AIDS crisis, there is plenty out there that you can start with educating yourself. It's going to be mostly about New York and San Francisco. Some stuff maybe about Paris, London, or LA. I would say, you know, anyone out there who writes nonfiction, or, you know, writes fiction and is up for a bunch of research, the stories of other cities, smaller cities, small towns, even for that matter, absolutely need to be told. There are cities like Milwaukee had its own completely unique, devastating story with this, where the Milwaukee story, it looks like many other cities until 1993, when there was a cryptosporidium outbreak in the water, and basically everyone with HIV died within about a week.
Oh my goodness.
And that happened nowhere else. That's not, you know, that's not the story of San Francisco. That's not the story of New York. That is the Milwaukee story. And, you know, when these books, you know, of course, the big general nonfiction books, they're going to follow, okay, what was the CDC doing? What was happening in the White House? What was ACT UP doing in New York? But we need to get these stories out there, and we need to do it while the people are still around who can tell them. For me, you know, I was writing this book from like 2014 until, you know, say 2017. It did get a little more politically charged in 2016 as I was writing, but in ways that I think were helpful to the book. I'm not drawing direct parallels to the modern day because my book ends in 2015.
Well, I mean, that's the other thing when I think about the fact that you didn't even have the 2015 timeline at the beginning, because you weave in the attacks that happened in Paris at that time too into the story.
Yeah, here's what happened. So this is another artist's residency story, and I swear I live artist residencies. It, because I have kids, though, I get the bulk of my writing done in those like 2 weeks days.
Yes.
Maybe twice a year if I'm really lucky. So, but I was staying at Ragdale, which is a wonderful residency not far from me here north of Chicago. And it was November of 2015. I was really working on those Fiona sections, which I was still trying to catch up at that point to the Yale sections. And so the task I'd set myself was just, you know, crank out the Fiona sections. I got to get something on paper so I can edit it. The way I decided to do it was I said, okay, I work a lot in Google calendars. So I kind of map out how my characters are going to spend their days in my own Google calendar.
Right.
I was like, I'm just going to have it be like today in Paris. This week I'm going to write per week in Paris, and I'm going to try to do a day each day. So, okay, it's November 3rd. I'm going to write November 3rd. And meanwhile, I really felt mentally like I was in Paris. I'm alone in a room all day with nothing to look at by my computer. And I'm walking around, in Google Maps, and I'm looking at all these photos. And I really, overactive imagination really felt like I was there. And then the terror attacks happened. Not knowing the future, oh my gosh, is this the start of a whole thing? I'm felt like, okay, now I have to move it back, but I wanted that 30 year gap. And what I liked that it was 30 years since my 1985, narrative began. For a while, I thought I'll just move it into 2016. 2016 will be a much more normal time to write about. No way now. No way that these characters are talking about anything other than politics in 2016. So I kept it in. I felt like thematically, ultimately, this was a book about the invasions of the world on people's personal lives.
I feel like I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't ask you to talk a little bit about the experience of being on the Seth Meyers show.
Oh,
and what that was like, how that came about.
It was great. Basically, he's one of the only TV hosts who does have authors on. So he's a hero. Yeah. Apparently. So a couple of things. One is I really just never assume that anyone hosting anyone on anything has actually read the book. He actually reads all the books. Yeah. It's really cool. I was talking, the producer had a chat with me like a week before the show, basically like a pre-interview. And she said something about, Seth's finishing the book this weekend. And I was like, really? She's like, oh yeah, he reads everything. He reads so fast. It's really annoying. Oh, okay. So he was a complete sweetheart, and he actually reads the books. It came about, I think publicists at publishing houses are just constantly sending books over there, and there's someone whose job it is to sort through them and to recommend books and to book authors every once in a while. So
that's a great job. How do I get that job?
Right? No kidding. Yeah. That's how it happened. They make you very comfortable. And it one of the things that was really fascinating to me was backstage, how much it so clearly was people's workplace. This is, people are, they've been working all day, they've been writing the jokes, and now they're all sitting down in this kind of lounge area backstage to watch on the screen, and they're relaxing finally. And the makeup people and the pictures of their kids everywhere. It was a work environment. And I don't know why that was so striking to me, but it was cool. And the most amazing thing to me is that there was something going on with their bathrooms. They were being repaired or something. So they sent me down the hall to use the bathroom. And where they sent me was to a Saturday Night Live dressing room.
So just down the hall.
I know. Because they're like, the studios are like back to back. And there's no one there. It's too early for, Monday. It's like Monday afternoon. There's no one there in the SNL area. So I use the bathroom, and then I'm walking back down. I kind of look down this side hall, and I'm like, oh my God, it's the hall. It's like, any host who leaves the monologue to go back into the hallway to talk to Lorne Michaels and do that whole offstage thing. It's the hall. I was geeking out about that. So it was great.
Just to dogpile on with my own story, when I found out that Rebecca had agreed to an interview for the podcast, I believe I wrote back to publicist extraordinaire Keith Britt and said something lovely and poetic like, suck it, Seth Meyers, or was it in your face, Seth Meyers? I can't remember. It was something really lovely. Again, you don't want to miss the conversation between Rebecca Mackay and Hannah Pittard happening Saturday, September 1st at the Decatur Book Festival. I hope to see you there at around 4:15. That's happening at Caricor Hall of Decatur First Baptist Church. It's been my privilege in the past year or so to interview more than 15 authors who are appearing at this year's festival. I had no idea that that was the case until my graphic designer friend Loring put together a flyer for the Literary Atlanta podcast. We'll be sharing it on our website at literaryatlanta.com and via our social media channels. We put together a list of all the authors, books, and interviews that we've had that will be a part of the festival this year, so you can prep for your weekend at the AJC Decatur Book Festival. A little pre-gaming for book nerds, if you will. Take a look at that flyer and start mapping out your schedule. You can see the full schedule and list of presenting authors at DecaturBookFestival.com. Thanks for listening to this episode. As always, you can find links to the people, books, and events mentioned in the podcast on our website at LiteraryAtlanta.com. You can listen to episodes there or download them wherever you like to get your podcast, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Radio Public, or TuneIn. I'm Allison Law, your host. Until next time, take care and stay lit curious. We'll